No, but it's unreal.
Yeah, it seems like he's just slight movement of the hand and he's got him in pain.
Here. Show him that one. Tell him to try and get out, but don't try too hard, otherwise his eyes will be bloodshot for 3 months. Try that one out.
He's hitting me kind of red in the head. I did. I think separate eyes from the body. Don't you think? Submission wrestling, and it comes through constant practice and get skilled at your trade where you can. I'm getting so stiffened up now with arthritis that I'm not as lively as I used to be, but I could give a fairly respectable account of myself, even with a tiger, you know. In fact, I wrestled the 650-pound tiger here one Stampede week, which is kind of a novel thing. And I wrestled the bear for the Fish and Game Society a couple of times. And he was about a 600-pound brown bear, and he had to be... There's a little element of risk wrestling them. If you get nasty, you've aroused them a little bit, get offended, or they get too playful with you. You don't know how to turn them off sometimes. If they're cuffing you around too much, they could, you know, get claws in the whole works. I've always kept them in good humor, though, so they never trained on me that much. Some of these lousy dogs are, you know, they get a good bull terrier or pit bull or a big Dane on you. They could give you a pretty good... I used to go to that Rockyford Rodeo for 25 years. They gave me a medal or a citation for 25 consecutive years of wrestling there. And I used to work out with a lot of the cowboys there sometimes, and I made fans out of them. They didn't know what to expect. They thought they were going to have some fun with me, you know. Well, they're going to catch me and see what maybe somewhat of a phony wrestler could do with a real tough. Cutting the air off is always a pretty good way of making you fight. Just a little mild adjusting here and there puts the pressure on the right spots where it comes on you, so it's like age coming up on you. It doesn't come up all of a sudden on you. Just get it nice and just move in quietly with it, and next thing you've got him so bottled up that his eyeballs are getting pushing and his head's getting a little red and his tongue is getting, you wonder if it's going to burst in the roots. You know, your tongue was getting pretty thick.
Yeah, I could feel it choking me.
You don't grab them and you let them kind of help themselves to the goodies. And then when you get them in the right position, you just kind of flow into it. If you're an artist, I can coax you into the... I say, now put this arm up here. And then there, then I want you to bring this arm up, now bring it up. And I don't actually tell you that, but I leave the gate open where you find your way up to the open gate, and you gotta let him maybe be going for something that he wants on you, and then you lead him out of position, and then you get your whole click. You got enough torque when I hook my leg in here, my belly in here, I can pull your head out of your, I call it the root puller, stump puller. I can pull your head almost out of your shoulders, and your chin is getting down here, and you're fairly folded up just like a, you know, where you hold them there for a few, enough to, so that they get a little thrill out of it, you know, and they get hard pressed, fighting, you know, and the fans that they've been impressing the other cowboys and the other boys look they always look frightened. You're frightened, but all you can do is wet yourself and pound your feet on the mat and shout a little bit, you know, let a few panicky squeals out, but you got him pretty, you can't squeal too much or say too much, you just got to go to sleep, and you could keep him. I could put it in both eyes, then boot you in the face with the, you know, like punting a football. You just go at it like you're stomping out a fire. Boom, 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 boom. It's like therapy to a good wrestler to be able to do this stuff sometimes. You know, it gives him relaxation, so it gives him pride in his work, maybe. I made a lot of fans down there in the dungeon, a lot of believers. I couldn't afford to be running down to the Y or to a place like BJ's every time I wanted to work out, so I've had a gym in my house since 1929 or so, when I first started amateur wrestling.
You know, my dad started training fellas down there. He had the gym, I think, built for himself, and then he, you know, just invite different, you know, good guys who wanted to get into wrestling, he'd invite them over to practice, and I think it just went from there. And then the boys, when they were growing up, they saw different wrestlers training there, and they just kind of followed in my dad's footsteps.
Most promoters promoted, and, you know, every now and then they would start somebody out, but Stu was one of these guys who grew up kind of being a fan of really tough guys or real physical, you know, guys who could lift a lot, and guys who were really tough, you know, when it came to submission wrestling. So Stu liked, you know, he liked starting guys off. And he, you know, a lot of guys who, you know, were athletes kind of wandering around, you know, Jim Neidhart was a guy like that, you know, kind of a, you know, a world-class shot putter. I don't know exactly where the connection was, but, you know, Stu brought him up, or he came up to Calgary, and, you know, Stu would take some football players and do that. He would take some lifters.
I had a pretty good exposure across the board, and I would be in contact with the various wrestlers, get to know them, and the good ones, we get kind of, they'd ask me if they'd come up and work for me, or if I could, I would see a good wrestler that I liked, I would invite them up here to join me, and they became superstars up here, or good performers, you know.
I think somebody like you just nicknamed it the Dungeon one day and it stuck. Now, no one knew where that came from, but it has remained, and it is infamous.
Sure, you know, I don't think originally it was even called the Dungeon. I'm not sure when I first heard that term, maybe facetiously or whatever, maybe in the maybe late 70s, early 80s, it was the first time I ever heard the term dungeon applied to it, but for years it was just sort of initially a place where my dad would be, he had this passion for shooting or the old style submission wrestling, so it kind of gained legendary status probably in the 50s. Stu was probably still in his prime then, and he had a number of these old, at least they probably weren't that old then, but these venerable or highly regarded shooter types that would go down there, and they would swap, you know, techniques and holds and perspectives and stuff. Guys like Luther Lindsay, and there's another guy named George Gordienko, and a few others that were in this elite circle of submission-style shooters, and they just go down there and do their thing, and I think it evolved later on where Stu would bring some of these aspiring guys who wanted to get into the wrestling business, and in those days it was a lot harder to get into the business, and the perceptible rationale in those days was you had to pay your dues in the dungeon or Stu's basement, and you had to go through guys like Stu and George Gordienko and Luther Lindsay and few of these other guys that were pretty damn tough. In those days, the business was not perceived or as universally recognized to be a worker, not on the level. In those days, it was, you know, in question, so they would stretch the hell out of these guys and not ever smarten them up for several times to see if they had any character, any staying power, and if they came back, they'd maybe stretch them again and do it two or three or four more times and punish them pretty damn good. And it was sort of like a test of a guy's mettle or his character. If they withstood all that without whining or whimpering or bitching too much, you know, Stu and company would then respect them enough to impart to them, you know, what the business was all about.
Some of the boys would work out with some of these young aspirants that wanted to be wrestlers and kick the hell out of them, give them, let them know that wrestling is a tough business, which it is.
If you torture a man because he was tortured by the shooters when he was young, and you survive, that makes you a man. And he would torture people. And he, I think in his own mind, it was like, if they survive, that makes them men.
I could use him as a guinea pig to demonstrate the whole set. Is that all right with you?
Yeah, that's great, sir.
I'll try not to too hard on you.
We all have a certain style, a certain attitude. You know, I remember Chris Benoit did a thing a few years ago with Mark Madden, and he very succinctly described that you have a certain attitude or a certain way of life, that if you come from the dungeon, you have to succeed, and it's almost like a commitment you have, and most of those guys had that, you know, used an overused cliche, that eye of the tiger, or that fire in their belly.
You're locked up you're in this position, say you're bullying, and you might be bullying in different. Then eventually, I get you pushing real hard, and I take you on over, and I pull you on over, you drop to your knee. You're in this position, and they can. Now, what I want to do is get this arm up here. Like if he can pull my head back, say it gives me a chance to push this arm up here. I push the arm in this position. Now, the next move is I want this arm to get involved. Now, just leave it there for the moment. I'll see if I can get him involved. Now, if I put my chin in, he brings the arm up to pull my head back, then I would turn him over and he still pushed my head, so I leave him push my head, and I turn him over this way. Now he's in this position, so I take my body and I push him with my body over here. Then I get to this position. I don't need tissue here on you. You know, his head was getting bright red, rosy looking. You can feel that in your throat a little bit.
It all caught up. I could hardly breathe.
It's a nice hole for demonstrating. There's a lot of little holes for this position. I might be in here. I might let him up a bit. Let him sit up a bit. And then I hook this leg under the arm here. Then I want this arm to go back here. When they take it back, you see that? And the more I take this arm back here, the needs more pressure on his neck. Now, that arm is too hard on him.
Thanks, Stu.
Then you can turn him over on his belly. I might pull this arm out here. And then I take him here. It hasn't hurt yet.
Oh, it's a boss.
Now, I'm in this position now. I'm starting to direct traffic here. See? He's getting kind of red in the head a little bit. You can feel
it. My left arm is numb.
I'm actually not putting too much pressure on them. If you know what you're doing, I can let you be kind of directing traffic. You're setting me up for something that you have in mind, and I'm letting you go to the point where there's not too much return for you, and then I spring the trap on you, and then I've got you in the in one of these holes, and you're pretty devastated with them here. There's not much. I'm not actually putting out that much strength with them, but you're feeling the power of them. One hold I find is always pretty successful. You grab me in a bear hug and I make out I'm suffering with it. I'm starting to, you know, sell the property, package a bit, and finally you get right in where you're going south with it, and you, then I get like if he were to give me a, well, you could do it, and I can just get your hair head gently, brother. And if I'm not digging enough, I'll put my chin in here, and you bite again, bite closer. You bite your own cheek. Double cradles is fairly good too, but the, I can try to pull your arm on you, lock your hand behind you, in front of you. I can put so much pressure on with my belly, throwing my belly into your back, and you're on your belly, then you can't get your arms, you can't pull your arms out because I got so much pressure that they, your knuckles are caught in the belly, and the, you can't get them out, then they're underneath, and then you can hook the head around here, and get your chin, I get your chin in here, then I pull the chin around here, and I keep my belly on you, and I pull the chin so that and then you can you put your little weight on the shoulder, a little on the head. You can hear the vertebrae kind of fitting in, click, 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 as they kind of snap into, crunch into place, you know.
They still broke in the very early 30s, I guess, and some of the old veterans that were old shooters that broke him and were in the business around the 1890s and the, you know, guys that were at the very inception of the business, from what Stu tells me, guys like Jack Taylor, who was Frank Gotch's chief adversary back around the turn of the century and one of the most legendary shooters that's ever come out of Canada and considered within the wrestling circles to be the equal of Gotch, who's considered one of the icons ever in the business. You know, a football equivalent would be maybe a Jim Thorpe, or a baseball, a Babe Ruth, or a Ty Cobb. You know, those guys who were turn of the century, roaring 20s, and that era, you know, legends. And so Stu's roots go back all the way back over 100 years, you know, to the very dawn of the business.
He was a great all-round athlete as well, but in wrestling he started in the 30s, became a great amateur wrestler, and went on to win Canadian titles. He served for his country during World War II, became a professional wrestler, and I remember so well in Madison Square Garden against the likes of what? Whipper Billy Watson and Lou Thesz and Frank Sexton and Buddy Rogers, a lot of the outstanding stars of the day, and you listed the name of Hart among those stars.
I can remember going to the first match in Madison Square Garden, and the people were lined up for 10 blocks around the arena trying to get in. There must have been 100,000 people cramming around there, and the place only held 25, 30,000 people at the most. I played the role of a local boy in Edmonton when I first started wrestling professionally. I was like a conquering hero coming back, like I'd been down in New York and I was supposed to hit the big time, which I did to some extent. You might say I had wrestled in every major city in every borough in New York, and either sometimes main events, but on the card so that you had the exposure. And then when you come up to a town like Edmonton, you were fairly, the fans bought you as a local boy that is returning from the big time. So you, if you had some good lively matches, good believable matches, you became quite a box office. I bought the equity in the promotion up here in 51. And that meant that I had Edmonton and Calgary, the two biggest centers in Western Canada, and they were, the interest was so good there that you could almost carry the rest of the territory just at Edmonton and Calgary, because every night was a, when we got it rolling there, every night was a sellout pretty well.
And it was there that in 1955 he established a television show, later to become known as Stampede Wrestling, and certainly later to become known around the world.
Here's Davey Boy, comes over, grabs him! Davey Boy off those ropes, pulls him over! One, two, oh! Oh, that was close!
It was kind of an interesting existence as a kid, I guess. It's kind of funny in retrospect because we were essentially marks, so we weren't smart till probably in our teens. Still kept us, you know, didn't share any of the inside elements of the business. And I remember I was sort of a half mark, and I'd be really angry that the bad guys were beating the good guys and all that type of stuff as a kid, you know, because I sort of have favorites, you know, some of the, you know, obviously most of the good guys. And when I did get to go, the student let us go down to the matches that often. Maybe when somebody's birthday, he'd take us down or something like that. But I remember we were always fiercely defending. Even in those days, there was this, you know, kids coming up as wrestling for me, you know, and it was usually fighting words to us because we believed ourselves in those days that it was on the level, you know, and we were fiercely defending it, and that was fighting words, you know. So
the wrestlers would go on the road on Monday, Lethbridge, Tuesday, Red Deer, Wednesday, Saskatoon, Thursday, Regina, Friday, Calgary, Saturday, Edmonton. But when they were in Calgary on Saturday morning, they would come to the house for their paychecks for the week, and they would bring their wives and children, and we would have the checks ready, and they would usually stay and have coffee and cake and things like that. It was like one huge family, all kinds of wrestlers all over, their wives, their children, sometimes their dogs.
It was sort of like a ongoing cast of these unusual, strange-looking characters. They're always sort of larger than life, these zany, colorful, unconventional types. And
it was just a mob on Saturday morning, and very friendly. And although we never intended it to be such, I think that's where we grew so close to the wrestlers, because they were like the family, and there's a lot of camaraderie, and we talked a lot. We grew very close with them.
I think it was definitely a different kind of atmosphere. The door was always open, and we had every shape, size, color, and male or female here growing up, and you learned to kind of keep an open attitude.
Off those ropes, look out now, good shoulder block. Over the top. Yes, sir, one. That's all.
Should just stop it. There's no question about it.
Well, he won't have a chance to stop it now.
Now, this whole thing is now out of control.
He's getting what he deserves.
That's it. Tell him.
Nobody deserves this. Nobody deserves this. This is past a wrestling bout. This is an exhibition in cruelty.
Bad News Allen has that strap on, so Archie Goldie and Bad News will get into some serious doings as of now.
No, do not adjust your set. This is Wendy Richter against Athol Foley.
Business wasn't always flourishing. It went through a lot of cycles. It was up and down, and I remember a lot of real tough financial times, and it was precarious because all the eggs were in that basket. If the crowds weren't good, sometimes there wasn't food on the table, and there was a lot of mouths to feed, and I remember some pretty lean times, and there was a hell of a lot of stress.
I can remember driving 4,000 miles a week and never sleeping more than a couple of nights a week. And you'd come in so damn tired that you could hardly, maybe from a trip to Regina, coming in from Spokane, or coming in from Idaho Falls, or coming in from Billings, or you'd be, hate to have to share the driving with another while the other wrestler pitch in and drive, and you'd catch a little sleep on the road, but I had to come up to get the kids going.
That's where I was fortunate. Stu, there was no job too big or too small for him. He could die for a baby while he put a headlock on you almost. It was, you wouldn't want that. But anyway, he was very helpful and versatile. He could do anything. And he was never chauvinistic, so he didn't think that's woman's work, this is men's. He just did, if it needed to be done, he did it.
Her father was a 1912 Olympic runner, and they had the five sisters, and I married her, and
I knew right away he was not my type, and he had been looking for a very athletic girl, which is not I. So, of course, we got married, having totally incompatible, had 12 children, and lived happily ever after, pretty well.
I was lucky with her. She was secretary to the president of the school board in Long Beach, New York, and she could take shorthand and typing as fast as I could talk. And I would phone her up from, say, from Great Falls or Billings or Idaho Falls or Spokane or Vancouver, and give her the lineup for, and she'd have it all typed up.
It's funny, once you're involved in wrestling, it seems you can't extricate yourself. And everybody was involved, even the little ones, soul programs, the big ones, would referee or tend the door or drive the truck, or they all did something, and it permeated our lives. After a while, the letter W for wrestling seems to leap out from a newspaper page, or if you're not even watching television and someone says wrestling, You're alert because you're so tuned to anything connected with or to do with wrestling.
You know, I think it was a little harder on my mom. She kind of survived it. My dad was on the road a lot, and she didn't drive a car or anything like that, and she still managed to, you know, try to have nice meals made and do the laundry and still work on my dad's, you know, business part too.
I thought very little of the wrestling business when I was introduced to it, and I think even less of it now.
Son, my wife isn't a wrestling fan.
I know she's always talking about how she's not.
It's not my type of entertainment, but for our own sakes, I'm glad somebody did like it.
In retrospect, would you have rather that maybe Stu was a carpenter and it was something easier?
Yes, I do have some regrets. Well, it meant my leaving New York City to go to Great Falls, Montana, where we started. And there was such a contrast there. I missed Broadway, and I missed a lot of my family. And yeah, I think I have some regrets there, but it was on its own kind of a rich life, you know, that I grew to enjoy in itself very much.
I was in New York at the time. Television was just starting to take hold in New York in 45, 46. Immediately after the war, almost, there was getting to be a little television. It sort of gathered momentum in the early 50s. Like, we had a pretty good wrestling circuit going here, where with radio and posters and things like that. But when television started coming across, they'd see the wrestling on television. Then the fans were phoning in, and could they see this wrestler? Could they see, why can't we see Whipper Watson? Why can't we see the boys that are on television? Can you get them up here sometime? We used to have to get the television boys out of Toronto to mean anything. Even you had good local boys, they wanted to see those boys they're seeing on television. If you don't have New York television, you don't have anything. The fans don't even buy the local television, hardly. They want to see the performers out of New York. Eventually, you'd get them up for a two-week period or something like that, and then you'd get the television advertised, and then they'd plug you, maybe give you a couple of announcements from Toronto that the boys will be on a Western tour, Whipper Watson, and they'll be coming up the first time in Western Canada. The great Whipper Watson, the British Empire champion and whatever. Then you couldn't find a building big enough to hold them then. And then you had to pay a pretty good fee for their services too. And you had to send a booking fee down for them to book you, the talent, and then you'd use your own local talent a little bit to wrestle one of the stars. And if you didn't have one of the stars to wrestle, the local boys didn't mean that much wrestling each other, yet they were fairly qualified wrestlers. And that's got to be the same thing. Vince has done that now in New York. They didn't need any help from the towns that they're sending boys into. Like, they dominated and they just ate the wherever they wanted to.
The commission, who were a bunch of old, kind of conservative old farts, started coming down on us pretty good. Anyway, somewhere along that line, Stu, I think it was the summer of 84, he was offered some kind of a deal by Vince to sell the promotion.
When I sold out to Vince McMahon, a lot of the boys that started here, they were my wrestlers, went down to New York, and they became stars down there with Vince.
Gama spots him. Ooh, kind of. Look at that impact. Yeah, watch out for this one. Hold him down. Got inside him. One, two, three. Got him. Whoa, how about that? Quick move by Neidhart. Look out. Pulls him over. Whoops. Cover, one, two, three, he did it! Davey Boy Smith! Davey Boy Smith has won the title!
the whole thing was essentially, out of business, like in 2 days' notice. So it was pretty disconcerting. Anyway, make a long story short, that deal where Vince and Stu had entered into this agreement kind of was abortive. And about a year later, Stu started up again from scratch. And almost all his top talent he had given away. They were either now with Vince or one of the other promotions in the States, which was, I guess, the Bill Watts or the NWA Crockett's thing or something like that. So he basically had to start virtually from scratch, and it was a pretty tough time around the end of 85, early 86, and it was a pretty daunting challenge because Hulkamania was at its peak and there was a lot of pressure on Stu, but we had a whole bunch of big musclehead bodybuilder types like Kaz Meyer and Tom McGee and Ted Arcidi types and a bunch of others. And I remember at that time we had a few small guys that nobody had ever heard of and everyone just thought they were throw-ins. And ultimately it was funny, early 86 and developed throughout the next few months, all these small guys rose and became huge stars. Ultimately, guys like Chris Benoit was just starting then. Pillman was just getting his feet wet. And Owen came in a short while after that. And Liger and Hussey came in. And
when Dynamite hit big, so this is late 70s, Stu opened up his territory to smaller guys. And it was hard for Stu because Stu was a big guy's kind of guy too. But when he saw Dynamite and how popular Dynamite was, it opened, they started having the smaller guys like Japan did. It was almost like a mini New Japan. And they had some of the best action anywhere in the world at the time because, you know, the small guys, fast-paced stuff that the American promotions were not doing at all.
All of a sudden, that was sort of the became the backbone of our whole promotion, was all these undersized little guys that had a lot of drive and they were bound to determine that they're going to rise above the Kaz Meyers and the Arcidis. And we kind of overcame a lot of odds and proved a lot of skeptics wrong.
When he came into the ring, you could see Owen Hart had the eye of the tiger.
Owen Hart, one of the more spectacular wrestlers to come out of the Hart Brothers pro wrestling camp.
Well, now you know why they call him Flying Brian Pillman.
Benoit looking very good.
And he is pouring on the pressure.
Yamada putting on a demonstration of speed and strength. Puts him down on the canvas. Hussey somersaults onto the midsection of the Great Gamma.
For all intents and purposes, nobody outside of maybe Western Canada knew who the hell we were. So, took Brett and Owen and some of them to increase the awareness. I think it was quite gratifying and reinforced, our belief that wrestling was still the primary product, and bullshit wasn't really the the heart and soul of the business. It was a source of pride, I guess, just as being related to them, and I think it reflected I like to think it reflected in some ways positively on myself to a small degree, because I was kind of a booker and had a lot to do with their development. But even more so, it was a positive reflection on Stu, you know. It kind of reinforced his legacy. And I think prior to that, Stu was sort of well known within sort of the hardcore and the wrestling circles, but I think it, you know, made him more of a well-known figure throughout the world.
Included in the troops that went down into the dungeon were his sons. There was a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that evolved, but nonetheless some remarkable coaching and, well, the results you know now. The results that have been an amazement around the world.
Bulldogs have been in complete control. They want those championship belts. Here comes a pile driver. Lemo! There's the tag. In comes Davey Boy.
Well, I tell you, that was a tremendous pile driver. He came right down in his knock, and I tell you, I don't know how he's even in this match. But that's how tough the Cubans are.
Look out, we're going to see a power slam!
Here he comes, he's on the top rope. Whoa! Flying dropkick. Summer Sizzler action. Incredible!
Everybody across the country, everybody across the United States of America and Britain and Japan are all here tonight, all taking pictures. Everybody knows what's happening in this wonderful city of Calgary.
Yeah, I know my brothers, Brett Norton, and some of my brothers-in-law, when they fought, the matches were so close that nobody could see any daylight through that, and you know, nobody was hurt. Like, the wrestling isn't table tennis; it's a hard contact sport.
Brett was a good, damn good high school wrestler. I was planning on sending him to the 1980 Olympics or something like that, I think it was, and he had the misfortune to. He was provincial champion and doing well in high school wrestling, and in this damn provincial match, somehow or other, he broke his collarbone. And it was a nasty break, and he couldn't, he was tied up for off wrestling for several months, and I had a match out at Rockyford. I used to go to Rockyford Rodeo every year since I've been in there for 25, 30 years in Rockyford Rodeo. So I had Brett go out there, and I needed a referee, so he refereed out there, and he got a little taste of the money, and then when he got his collarbone back in, then the Olympics had already got passed while he was recuperating from this damn thing, and so then he got a taste of the money, and I remember asking him, would he wait till the next Olympics? He says, I can't afford to do that. He says, I like to be driving a Cadillac car, and being I'd rather that means more to me than maybe going to the, I can't eat the medal that I get from the Olympics, and maybe I don't get a medal. So he stayed with wrestling then, and he caught on like a duck into water, you know. He just picked it up and was almost an instant instant star there. He had some good guys to work with, boys like the Dynamite Kid, and who was always a colorful, spectacular boy. And then there were some other boys, like David Schultz was like a southern politician. He could talk, and aggravate people to the point where they want to kill him, but and a classy, clean, and clever kid like Brett could wrestle him, and they tear the house down. And a local boy like Brett or Bruce or Keith or some of my other boys there, Owen, they could wrestle some of the big dreadnoughts like Mike Shaw, who weighed about 350 pounds, and the fans loved to hate him. And I remember him wrestling Owen up in Fort McMurray, and they must have turned away, I don't know how many thousand people up there, and that's not a... I think everybody in the area was at the matches that night. Owen wrestled Mike Shaw, and it was a, I guess, a riot from what I hear, but it's satisfying to see the fans have a hell of a show for their money.
The only people that look unhappy in this capacity crowd are standing at ringside Drago Zhivago and Miss Honey.
Well, Owen's a natural worker. You know, I mean, one of the things with Owen Hart, and it's actually, I noticed a lot of parallels with Owen Hart and Eddie Guerrero. They had the wrestling family. They had the ring in their backyard. They were goofing around in the ring in childhood. When Owen Hart was a rookie and broke into wrestling, Stampede was looking for a new Hart star because Brett was on the road. And Bruce had reopened it, and he just wanted Owen to be the new star. And Owen took to wrestling just right away. I mean, I remember a couple of weeks into his career, I'm going like, wow, you know, this guy's like, you know, he's really good. Then like 2 months later, it was like, man, this guy's like, you know, one of the best in the, you know, one of the best there is.
Owen Hart reaching down once again, pulling himself up. He's groggy, but he's game.
My son Owen, he's been wrestling since he was 4 or 5 years old, and he was Canadian college champion in on a wrestling scholarship at the University of Alberta, University of Calgary. And when he broke into wrestling, he's 16, 17 years old maybe then, you know, fairly. And he had a certain amount of charisma, the fans just took to him. He became an all-time favorite, the same with Brett. Boys like Chris Benoit actually developed their skills here working out with Owen when he was a pup. Mm-hmm. And he was a... I know he had wrestling charisma that sort of... caught the promoter's eye, and yet he was very popular. He was one of the most popular athletes that I know. He had few enemies and many friends. I never met anybody that didn't have a good word for him. He was never trying to outshine the other guy or trying to steal the show. Yet he had enough charisma that he could throw a timely drop kick or a pretty witty, pretty shady skills with the opponent too, pretty well.
Wrestling Owen Hart, you know, okay, forget about wrestling. He was one of the funniest guys you'll ever meet. And he was a clown. Like, he would do ribs, like we'd be in the ring and he'd put me in a hammerlock or put me in a chin lock and have me there. And, you know, you're, I looked down and he'd untied my pants. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, and you hear Owen go, and what are you doing? Or you'd look up and he'd untie the referee's shoes and no one would know he's doing this. You're like, what are you doing? He just, and he'd tell you a joke and you're like, wait a minute, I'm having a match here.
we were pretty well dumbfounded when we heard it on the, we were watching television and we got it right from the, as it was being, as the tragedy was happening, we were watching it on television and it, it hit you like a, an explosion. You, it's hard to believe you see your son destroyed right in front of you. Destroyed, never see him again, never, he's out of your life.
That night was rough. Because, you know, we were in the back and we were talking over, you know, we had a great match. It was, oh, everything was good, everything was good. And then the B-roll of his entrance came in where, you know, he's eat your vitamins and brush your teeth, you know, doing the blue blazer stuff, the, yeah. You know, stuff. And yeah. And at the time he's being lowered down and then the video was cut short and, you know, there's Jim Ross talking about there's been a horrible accident. We're like, what? And an image that'll never leave me. I don't care what happens. You know, Jerry Lawler's a cut up. He is just, what you see on TV is about this much of who he really is. Mm-hmm. Okay, he's just a class clown. And he came back with this pale white face, stone face, and he said, I think he's dead. I'll never, ever forget that. And then watching Owen come by on the gurney was bad. I mean, it was like, you know, you're like, okay, maybe he didn't fall from that far, and maybe he's just knocked out. And we got the word. We got the word before it was announced on TV. We got it not quite some time, but enough advance warning where we're just sitting there and guys start to file out and go to their hotels, and long night that was. And it was even worse the next day. We flew to St. Louis and you look at the plane, airplane seat where Owen's supposed to be sitting. It's like, oh, ooh.
Owen's loss was certainly devastating, and it angered me a lot because of all people, he was a guy who was a consummate craftsman and a guy who didn't really need any artificial additives or glitz and horseshit. You know, he could work incredible and all like that, so you didn't need to compromise his greatness with props and coming in on a tightrope and all that crap. But it was devastating to the family, and it's continues to be sort of an issue that's divided the family. There's tremendous bitterness between Brett and Davey and some of my sisters, and over allegiance to Vince and different things. It's been tremendously dividing. It's been saddening, and it's caused a lot of grief and hardship. It was a pretty good, devastating thing to the family, and the family I don't think has recovered from it. I'm not sure that they ever will.
I don't think there's even been any closure on it yet. So much has happened since then, and I don't feel anyone's had a chance to really deal with it yet. Everybody's got their own feelings about it, so it's been hard. I think it's built a bit of a rift in the family, and hopefully that'll smooth over one day.
You don't get over it, you know, but you all of us held together at that time. We pulled together, and my children have, for the most part, been very supportive of Stu and me. They're very good to us. Not as good to each other sometimes, but very good to us. They love their dad.
Life goes on, and it's been life and death is they're two important things, and they're out of our hands. We don't know when our time comes up. The best you can do is try to be as enjoy life as much as possible and not make too many enemies along the road.
My name is Attila Kanalidis. My parents are Turkish, but I was born and grew up in Germany. Why I came to Canada? Because the Hart brothers are the world famous wrestlers in the world. No? The Dungeon is very famous, and perhaps in 10 years, when I am a superstar of wrestling, I hope so, yeah. And somebody asked me, where do you learn wrestling? I can tell him with the proud of the Dungeon, no?
Yeah. The Dungeon, I think, has the best reputation out of all the training facilities.
It's a little bit different than training in like a ring, you know? To me, it's like you come here and you appreciate the little things because we're training in such a, it's pretty much a harsh environment. You know?
Training in the Dungeon was murder. The first 2 weeks I could hardly walk.
It's a hardcore training, you know. You don't come there if you're not ready or prepared. You're just going to hurt yourself and you'll get hurt. And after when you're done training with the Dungeon, you can go pretty much every independent promotion or even an hour level and make a good name of yourself because they don't. You know how to bump.
It was kind of a weird experience because I watched the Bret Hart video and they had the Dungeon and everything, and you know, it kind of made it like a, it was like this dark secret place, and it was like I walked in the door from the side there and I was like, this is the Dungeon.
I want to learn a lot of submission wrestling and technical wrestling. I think this place is the only place I think in wrestling that you could probably learn the art, and before it all fades away and before it becomes into like a ballroom dance or something, you know, the heritage and the respect of this place and the way it's taught, I mean, that's what I want to learn from here, to get a solid background. And one thing great about it is that I get a chance to be with my hero here. That's something really great for me.
We begin our look at the Brothers Hart with Keith. He started out 1973, stayed prominent for about a decade, He teamed up with his brother Brett. He was very effective in the tag team division. Teamed up with Brett to win the international tag team belts three times. He also won the British Commonwealth's mid-heavyweight title. Man, there was great action in the mid-heavyweight division in those and subsequent years.
Big toss. He's going to come at him with a knee drop. Oh, and he hurt his knee. Figure four. He's got the four on him.
To win, let me see, half a dozen mid-heavyweight titles and the international tag team belt. I'm talking about Bruce Hart, who rose to prominence in the 70s, continued throughout the 80s, and became a name known not only with Stampede Wrestling, but absolutely throughout the world.
The three count! Bruce Hart is the new mid-heavyweight champion of the world! And this arena is going crazy. This place is just going completely crazy. Bruce Hart swinging that belt.
Bruce is a great teacher. I came here and I didn't have any like amateur wrestling background or nothing. I played all sorts of other sports. I just never got into wrestling. And it's been 6 months. I can say I can wrestle. I've had 5 matches already. And he definitely, the whole Hart family knows their wrestling. And I'm definitely glad that Bruce is my teacher, and I have a lot of respect for him. And I'm happy that he still takes the time to come down here and train us.
Excellent trainer. Good at teaching you stuff, teach you how to bumps, teaches you about psychology.
It's an honor, actually, to be able to train under someone such as Bruce. It's an honor.
I'd rather be training here than anywhere else.
We start from the basics and go from there. Try to impart a lot of little things about the psychology, the timing, the interaction, and try to qualify everything with a rationale or an explanation for why we're wanting to do what they're doing. We have a pretty good idea what succeeds and what doesn't, and why it works, why it doesn't.
Yeah. Tackle, drop down, get it again. It's a called spot. Okay, tackle. Good impact. Drop down. Stop. Turn around, Dave. Hey, Dave. Should have turned around the other way. It looks a lot more plausible and credible and logical. Okay. You'd be dazed, disoriented, and whatever else. You turn around and you walk back into it, appearing as though you're not sure you were dazed or whatever from the initial impact, and thereby kind of a little bit unsure of where you're at, and you turn around and boom, he takes you. If you just get up, see him standing there, and walk right back into it, it looks less plausible. So you always want to endeavor to strive to have plausible, logical stuff to where the fans don't keep saying, geez, why did that idiot do that?
One of the biggest problems in the business right now is even if you're an incredible teacher and you impart things compellingly and everything else, there's not enough opportunity to break in. Like, we have a little bit of a promotion out here, and you know, we're trying to break in some guys, but I think and I'm not sure it'll ever return, there needs to be more minor league or more of a network of smaller promotions that are quality promotions, not backyard promotions or horseshit ECW style, like extreme style, you know.
Training since February and heard a lot about this place. Looks like come out here, get pretzeled out, beat up.
It starts with a lie. They flow like wine.
going to the gym or something, they usually tell you to start slow, work yourself up to that level. But this is just like 0 to 100.
People that think that wrestling isn't fake, and they think that we don't hurt each other and we don't get hurt and we don't sustain injuries. That's all BS. Training is very hard.
I would say that amateur's not more real than pro in a way, because there's a lot more injuries in pro wrestling than there is in amateur. You don't hear about guys having to get neck surgery from amateur wrestling. I think the fans still have got it in their minds that the wrestlers aren't really getting hurt, and that they're just, it's just sort of a big performance. But
are you worried about getting injured yourself?
I don't really think about it. No,
you can't. It makes for bad matches. You worry about what's going to happen. While you're in the match, you can't think about it.
During the match, I'm more concerned about putting on a good show. I'd rather take the big bump just to get a good pop from the crowd. And it's kind of after the match when you look back, or you might feel a little stiff, where you think, oh, you know, I could have got really hurt on that. But during the moment where you got the adrenaline, you don't really feel much pain at all.
I'll be honest with you, I think about it sometimes. When I sort of walk out to the door, I forget about everything. And I just do what I got to do. I just forget it.
Everybody I've talked to says that, you know, when you get out there, you feel like Superman. You feel like you can do anything. Is that true? Does the adrenaline do that to you?
Yeah. Oh yeah. That is true. Superman. I've even done stuff out there, and then I watch the tape after. I'm like, I don't know what I was doing there, but.
I generally try to give him a fairly good amount of freedom. I'm not, into giving them step by step, move by move, over scripting of everything they do, because my estimation, the essence of working is ad-libbing, or allowing guys to improvise on the fly.
Bring your fans in here, get involved.
And now you're pissing me off here!
And if you can get people to understand that there's a story being told, they get involved in the story instead of two guys just punch, punch, kick, kick, and away it goes.
Yep, and I think it's important for a professional wrestler to transcend audience expectations in professional wrestling conventions.
We're there to tell a storyline.
It's how a wrestler.
What kind of bullshit is that?
You need to see wrestlers, such as Crazy Horse Eddie Mustang, entering the ring and setting examples of artistic integrity. they've never before been seen in the ring. You need to.
Should be entertaining no matter what order it is on the card. It should be always believable. Well, you know, you can have 10 matches in a row on a card or whatever, if that's quite a heavy card, but you know, and if one guy throws one really phony looking punch, technically if it looks phony, it is phony, that ruins it for the whole thing. It's like one man on a virgin, or that's all it takes. It's she's no longer, it's different now. It's phony. She's not a legitimate. Then she's like she's deflowered or whatever. So this is a horrible example, but anyway.
Six minutes. I was trying to call a spot at the end there where Rob was on me. I just wanted to do a turnaround real quick.
Just remember, man, when you're calling shit, remember, listen to the count.
Yeah, I know.
Is this your match?
This is our baseball match.
This is on my silverware. Fake it!
This is your season, my dude. This is on my season.
Bend over, boy.
I don't know. Just tell them to play baseball music or whatever.
What are they doing?
Just somebody go out, man. This is awesome. Just fucking music.
Just go.
Yeah,
you guys
will go out for. Okay. People are there.
All right.
There you go.
Showing you the final moves in them. I've been fooling around with it for it's worth 50 years or so, 60 years maybe, even 70 years. When I was around 12, 14, I was picking this stuff up. By being mauled by the better wrestlers. You feel that?
Yeah.
I lean back. This is harder on me than it is on you.
Really?
Because I'm stiff and used up. I used to be a nimble with it. I could put this stuff on without drawing a breath. And it would.
Well, it still hurts like hell.
I can have your arm up here, just my leg over your head,
yeah.
Like I try to do.
Yeah.
Then hook my toe in your arm, and then I lay here, mm-hmm. And I pull your head up.
With your leg?
With my leg.
Yeah.
And I sit back like this, with your head still coming in.
Yeah.
My leg goes around here. That is pretty. I'm so out of shape right now that I'd have to have a lot of nerve demonstrating on anybody. I've lost the. I've gone to the point where there's not much left of me. Just a matter of time till the boss man takes over. If I get another couple of anything is bonus from now on till I finish my journey. If I get 6 months, a year, or 10 days, or when you get 86, you're not gonna last too much longer. You can do the nominal things like saying hello and that. Not being too sporty, but anybody that thinks he's gotta live indefinitely see those holes are fairly severe, aren't they?
My grandpa used to play pro soccer for Manchester United.
Really? Well, they're my team. Because they were my grandfather's team.
Oh, right on. Harry the Skipper Gilmore, he was called. He was really good, too. It was before World War II. He was like a star, like a forward or something. He was really good. And then after the war, well, no soccer.
Yeah, anymore. Of course, yeah. It's a really small world, isn't it?
Yeah. We're ready. Ready?
World-famous Hart Mansion is being sold, and there is a final camp taking place on August 14th.
Richardson developers, they have bought the house. I think they are trying to preserve the original house, but a lot of the rooms they've replaced and rebuilt. So is that preservation? It's kind of questionable. The landscape itself, you know, they're building condos on. And the carriage house, they are going to demolish that.
Father was a real role model. He doesn't smoke, he doesn't drink, he never ever touched drugs and never was tempted by, as far as I know, any other woman. So we've grown, and when you have good principles, as Stu does, you set a pretty good example for the children.
A lot of guys that should have made it fell by the wayside because they didn't have the heart. A lot of guys that nobody thought were going to make it succeeded in spite of other shortcomings.
Platy block, 1, 2, 3, it's over! We have a new Commonwealth mid-heavyweight champion, Chris Benoit! The crowd is going crazy! Chris Benoit is the new champion, and listen to this crowd!
This is the greatest moment of my life!
Everybody who wants to be a wrestler, yeah, it's very hard. For example, I don't know where I can stay tonight, you know what I mean? it's very hard.
I'd like to wrestle for a good solid career, 10 years, and retire.
So you think you can get out of there before 40, unlike just about everybody else in the business?
Yeah. Well, I hope so.
How far you go, as much as anything, is determined by how badly you want it and how much you're prepared to sacrifice.
Now that I've trained with the Harts, I've been to a couple other places and I now realize just how good their training actually is.
Now I want to be able to make one day a living out of it. I got paid, but hey, I'm doing it and hopefully the pain's going to go away. I'm just happy to get back here, you know?
You know, I love wrestling and I'll probably do it for the rest of my life now that I've got into it, but I mean, I'm going to push and I come down here every day. I don't miss any practices and I want to someday make it big.
I knew we were not meant for each other, so now here we are, nearly 53 years later. We married on New Year's Eve, wouldn't you know? Someone once said they were all dressed up and have no place to go, so they got married, but that wasn't quite correct.
Pick a few flowers and enjoy the good things in life. It's a wonderful place to be. Living in Canada and the United States are good places, and there's life is precious.
Thank you.
that you saw. The sun and the stars, there's a man in the moon, yeah. The little boy blue and the dish and the spoon. I love the way they made me feel. Oh, I love the way they made me feel. Truly, the emperor's got new clothes. Can't you see? Oh, 'cause I know where the sky fell. Won't you follow me? All I could hear as I danced from the room was the sound of your clapping and the laughter in the wind. And hold tight. And hold tight.
Okay, on the line right now, we're patched through to Calgary, Alberta, Canada. We are talking to Ross Hart, one of the world-famous Hart brothers who runs the world-famous Dungeon Training Camp. Ross Hart, how are you doing today, sir? How are you?
Just great, Blake, and hello to all our fans there in the UK, and you have a great history of wrestling there, and it's a pleasure for me to be on your show.
Fantastic. Well, there's a lot of different things I want to talk to you about. I suppose the most pressing is that the Hart Mansion, the world-famous Hart Mansion, where so many great wrestlers were born and bred, yourself, your brothers, Brett and Owen and Bruce, your father, everybody's, the house has been going for, what, 50 years now. It is being sold, and there is a final camp taking place on August 14th. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, Blake. The house has been sold. Development group called Richardson Developers. They've been well known for restoring historical sites such as the Lougheed Building in Calgary, which most Albertans are very familiar with. They have bought the house and property, and I think people will be pleased that the house will not be torn down. The condition of the sale is that it remains standing, and it will be a historical landmark. They'll be doing some badly needed renovations for it, but I believe all the rooms will remain intact, including the dungeon and the spacious living room and dining room and the office where Stu and Helen Hart worked every day for so many years. So that's encouraging that the house will remain standing.
How was the decision made to sell it, and how difficult was it to make that decision?
It was pretty difficult. Without going into a lot of details, it was what my parents had requested when deciding the terms of their estate, and the house should be sold, but with the condition, of course, that it remains standing and never to be torn down. And I know a lot of Calgarians, and of course people in the wrestling industry, are very relieved with that, because there's just so much history there with the family, with the wrestling industry. And I'm hoping that the dungeon itself is preserved as a historical center for wrestling, because I think more top wrestlers developed in the industry in the dungeon than anywhere else.
Mm-hmm. Now the dungeon is closing up shop. Is the training going to continue? As important as the house, as long as it's gone on, the training has gone on. Are people still going to have the opportunity to be trained by you and by Bruce and by the Hart family?
Absolutely. I can't say for sure where, Blake. We haven't really finalized where we'd be relocating the dungeon. It might be at the Sportsplex in Calgary, where we have shows every 2 weeks. There's a couple of other centers possibly available. BJ's Gym, where a lot of the wrestlers do their weight training downtown in Calgary. There are some other possible sites, but I know training will resume, but in another location. So I think that's a very important benefit to the wrestlers who are still training in the dungeon right now, and for up and coming new stars, who are just going to be starting their training. So there will be a new center for training. I just can't say where at the moment. Hopefully that'll be determined by the end of this summer.
There's been an amazing list of alumni through the dungeon. Chris Benoit, Chris Jericho, Lance Storm, yourself, Bret and Owen, and then the list of people who've gone through who haven't necessarily trained there but weren't there, it expands into all corners of wrestling. What are some of the memories you hold closest from the 50 years that the dungeon was in operation?
Boy, so many memories. I mean, a lot of these guys did develop and get their early training in the dungeon, like the ones you just mentioned, and they're certainly the most contemporary of stars today, like Benoit, Jericho, and Lance Storm. It was a place where so many guys either got their initial training or further developed their training, quite often with my father, Stu, who would show the art of submission style wrestling. We're working with other teachers. I remember Bret developing there with Mr. Hito and Mr. Sakurada and getting his training there. My brother Bruce, who worked with an old Spanish veteran named Francisco Garcia. Rick Martel was training with Bruce at that same time in the early 70s. Dynamite Kid and Davey Boy Smith doing a lot of their early training there. Owen himself, it was the training ground for so many great wrestlers. Some who worked with Stu, some who polished more of their professional moves. Guys who used the training facilities and did weights and cardio. I remember Jim Neidhart using that infamous treadmill, which is still there, that he had gotten from the San Diego Chargers, and all these guys used to use that treadmill as their conditioning for trips to Japan. You know, I mean, it was just amazing. And you know, the dungeon itself was that meeting place, and then you know, they would, you know, lounge afterward upstairs, you know, in the hard house. So you know, it was the focal point really of the whole promotion and the training that went on with all those wrestlers.
Even in later years, when Stu wasn't training people regularly, or the aura of the house, Stu and Helen were such a strong part of it. It was their house, and everybody who went in could feel that, they could sense that. And when visitors came to Sunday dinner, Helen was at one end of the table and Stu was at the other. When they passed away, how did that change the feeling when it came to training in the dungeon?
Yeah, it was certainly a feeling of emptiness. You know, even when my mom passed away 3 years ago, and you know, Stu was, I wouldn't say the remaining pillar, but you know, he, you know, was sort of the survivor there of a relationship that was over 54 years, and you know, it was a tremendous marriage and partnership in wrestling, as most people know. You know, Stu and Helen ran all aspects of the wrestling promotion. You know, booking the talent, running the towns, arranging the TV production every week. It was a great partnership, and they're able to balance that with running the household and raising 12 kids and many grandchildren to follow, and still having you know, the Sunday dinners on weekends. You know, there was always time set aside for some of you know, the less formal, more serious functions. So, you know, it certainly didn't seem as complete, you know, after they both passed away. And you know, we still carried on traditions of having a lot of Sunday dinners and special occasions like Thanksgiving and Christmas, which, you know, I credit my sisters, George and Ellie, for, because they worked very hard to uphold those traditions that my parents would have wanted. And I know that's going to be a tough, you know, a tough tradition to let go of once the house is definitely sold. And, you know, I hope we as a family can still stay together. And I think since we're all living in Calgary, that will be possible. But certainly the end of a very glorious era.
One of the links between yesterday and today, which I always established since meeting Stu and since meeting Chris Benoit, was the link they had together. And the way people speak of Chris Benoit in the business today reminds me so much of how I've heard people speak of Stu at the house and when Stu isn't around. How important was it for Chris to come down to film the final WWE shots? Him finally world champion in the dungeon in Calgary a couple of months ago. This will be the last that wrestling fans on a worldwide scale see as the dungeon. This is Chris Benoit with the title standing where it all began.
I think it's very important. I think Chris has had tremendous success, and by no means does he owe all of it, you know, to his early training in the dungeon and wrestling with Stampede for so many years. But
he credits it.
Yeah, you know, and you know, he's a very modest fellow, Chris, but he developed here because he had a lot of talent, and I think he benefited from what the Stampede promotion was able to offer him, you know, a chance to start on a smaller promotion. And he developed so well, and yet I think a lot of my dad's influence helped him as well. You know, my dad was a teacher and a mentor to him, and like a father figure. I think he taught Chris so many survival skills, you know, different tips or pointers on, you know, how to work for different promoters and getting along with other wrestlers, and, you know, ways to hopefully manage his money. And I think Chris benefited from that. When he initially broke in, I recall, in the fall of 1985, he stayed at the Hart House for about 4 to 6 weeks. He was training very hard, I remember, with my brother Bruce and I, and was a guest there. My parents always had a very open-door policy with wrestlers, but Chris, of course, was a very gracious guest, and you know, I think that was an enjoyable time for him, and I certainly remember that. You know, he was just sort of like part of the family, as Dynamite Kid and Davey Boy Smith and so many others had been before, and you know, not to anyone's surprise, a lot of them married into our family with some of my sisters and in-laws, and it was I think something that Chris really remembered and cherished. You know, this is where his career started. This is where it all began for him, and I'd always had a very special place for Calgary, and of course Edmonton, where he came from, and it all culminated in him winning the WWE title earlier this year, and I know we were all extremely proud of him, and happy for his success, because he really deserved it, and you know, he obviously reaped the rewards of the Stampede promotion and his early training in the dungeon.
Mm-hmm. What names do you think we should look for in the near future coming from the dungeon, the new generation of wrestlers? One I want to throw by your way is a man who people say is incredibly talented, but they feel that a lot of critics feel he needs to focus up on what he wants and focus on his goals in wrestling, and that would be your nephew Ted Hart.
Yeah, Ted is certainly one of the more dynamic stars on the horizon. Has a very controversial image. You know, some fans or people in the industry love him, some hate him. I think that's what makes him a little more unique than some of the other family members. But certainly, you know, a lot of talent. You know, Ted is you know. I don't know how to describe, kind of an off-the-wall performer. He does some incredible, spectacular moves, somewhat which are very high risk. You know, that would be my only concern, is that he's not putting himself at too much risk with some of his moves, because, you know, it could spell the end of a very promising career. But I think he certainly has the talent. And I've seen him have incredible matches with, you know, wrestlers from our promotion against Sabu in a kind of a hardcore match he had a year and a half ago. But I think he's a very dynamic, versatile performer. You know, are those skills what different promoters want? I don't know for sure. You know, I think there has to be a bit of a balance there where you can wrestle for any given promotion and you know, have the mat techniques, but also the, you know, the interpersonal skills and the rapport with other wrestlers. And I think if Ted can find that balance there, he's going to be a very highly sought after commodity in the industry. And you know, some of the others that you're probably going to ask me about, like TJ Wilson and Harry Smith, are still continuously training in the dungeon, and are touring Japan and Great Britain and various independents throughout North America. And I certainly see Harry and TJ and Ted and even Natty Neidhart, who's the first third-generation woman wrestler, as the real big stars of tomorrow that mm-hmm. come from the dungeon.
That's fantastic. Now, before I let you go, I know that you're going to be heading over to Japan very soon. Why don't
yes.
you tell us a little bit about who's heading over with you and what you're going to be doing there?
Thanks, Blake. I'm going over for the WrestleAid promotion, headed by Go Ryuma, maybe better known North America to some fans as Roshi Yagi. He himself got his start in the dungeon mm-hmm. in the mid-70s, and had a pretty successful career with the IWE, and then later with New Japan, and then has started his own promotion, and he's using primarily some stars from Stampede Wrestling and the NWA, and mm-hmm. I understand he has a Super Junior tournament coming up from July 23rd on. Actually, July 22nd, I'm sorry about that, and mm-hmm. He's featuring Teddy Hart, Jack Evans, Rod Rage and Joe E. Legend in the heavyweight division, so it's a very exciting opportunity for me to go over as a representative of Stampede Wrestling, and I think it's going to be a great tour, and you know, a chance for some of the up-and-coming Stampede stars to showcase their talent.
Excellent. Now, I'm going to finish off the segment right here, but you can stay up right on the line after I let you go on camera.
Okay,
Blake. We're just going to edit this a little second out. Well, that sounds wonderful. Thank you so much.
Oh, great, great, Blake. I hope it goes well, and I was able to, you know, answer all the questions as coherently and concisely as I could. And
as you always do,
pleasure to be on there.
Well, thank you so much, Ross.
My
very best to you.
Absolutely,
and
Blake. Keep in touch with me. Even email me. I know I'm very hard to get a hold of. So thanks for your patience, and I hope you do incredible over there. You know, you got a lot of talent, and boy, if you can make a name for yourself in the wrestling world and in this very tough age, because it's really hard to stand out unless you've got something outrageous or crazy. But if you do, then I'd be so happy for you. But you know, you've done so much for the business, more than it's done for you probably. But you know, that's what keeps this industry going. So, you know, the extra work and you know, dedication, you know, with guys like you, whether you're wrestling or reporting or acting as a journalist. So that's great. I mean, I hope you can keep doing it as long as it's fulfilling and rewarding for you.
Well, thank you, Ross. It's been a real pleasure to talk to you. I'll talk
to
you,
Blake.
Soon.
Okay, let's keep in touch. All right.
You bet. Take care.
Okay, take care. Thanks. Bye bye.
Interesting show. I don't know where they got the damn tape, but it showed this water buffalo he was feeding under a tree, sort of just grazing, and this damned tiger, I think it's a tiger or a, he jumped out of the tree onto the, come down from maybe 10 feet down and landed on the water buffalo's head. Well, you ever see that film where the clip where the water buffalo was feeding under the tree?
Yeah, I saw that. The tiger jumps on his head and he rammed the tiger hard and then heaved him and went on eating, kicked a bit of dirt at the tiger.
He went on feeding like nothing had happened. The buffalo jumped, the damned tiger jumped down on his head from the tree and landed on him. And he just took the water buffalo, the tiger's, it showed the film where the tiger's hanging, his front legs are hanging over on the ground, you might say, and he's biting the, he's got his teeth and arms around the, paws around the neck, and the damn water buffalo just ran into the tree with the tiger hanging over his front, and he hit the tree so hard that he just gave him a toss, and you see the damn tiger fall dead.
Oh, God.
They never moved. And then the damn water buffalo went on eating grass like nothing had happened.
Oh,
I don't know where
gosh.
They get these damn films like this. I've been lucky pretty well. I can't recall ever having a street fight in my life. Nobody had an occasion, nobody wanting to fight me. I was either maybe diplomatic enough where I never pulled anybody's tail to the point where they wanted to fight me on the street, or I've had them in the gym, you know, where they, I used to have a little fun at the Palace Gardens when I worked up there. There was a fairly lively dance hall up in Edmonton. They had about 1,200 people in there on a Saturday night, and they be jumping around their tight, you know, where they can hardly, you take 1,200 people in a, in a dance hall about, here's the upper floor of it, maybe a, about twice as big as this house here, maybe, where they, pretty good sized room, you know, and they dance in there, belly to belly, you know, there's not too much room in there. You get the odd guy that had to have attention, you know, like he's fighting with somebody or he's quarrelsome, they had a little too much beer in him and wanting to expand himself a little bit. Old Joe White would say, get him out of there, Stewie. Grab him, get him out. And you'd have to take somebody out. You always use the diplomatic approach, you know. Come on, don't get too carried away. You have to quiet down a little bit. And, what do you mean, quiet down? They want to fight you, you know. Well, then you talk them out of it if you can. And then if you have to fight them, or if a couple of guys are fighting, you got to maybe catch them, her wife and them, and her boyfriend having it out, her woman, her boyfriend. You have to, you know, use diplomacy, and then you have to watch. They don't have a switchblade they might stick you in the ribs with or something. I remember one time I was there in the toilet, the guy had a, he was fighting with somebody, and I had to go in and get him, and he stabbed me in the roof of the mouth somehow or other with a short blade, and cut the just up on the roof, nothing. He bled a little bit, but I, think I gave him a good elbow along the head and knocked him silly. You can hit pretty hard with an elbow, or if you get him up, tell you to take a guy out through a door and give him a shoulder block, and like he's caught between, you know, the door kind of against his ribs, there you can almost cut him in half with a good with a good shoulder block, like a tackle, almost a short tackle, just, and his body is caught in the jamb of the door where you, there's nothing but his body between the door and you, and you can give him a good heavy tackle. And if you get him to hang on to it, it's twice his ribs.
Bell to bell, Chris Benoit is one of the best wrestlers I've ever seen. Everywhere he's gone, great wrestler. You know, grew up watching Stampede Wrestling and Dynamite Kid. And I mean, this is the other side of the of Stu is, you know, he came and, you know, he stayed in Stu's house learning to wrestle. Didn't have to pay, you know, Stu or anything like that. They didn't charge him thousands and thousands of dollars. And I mean, Chris never forgot that. And it was, you know, I mean, he, you know, Stu's almost like a father to him, you know. And and he, you know, he wasn't the only one. He was just the one who probably got the farthest and probably, I would say, wanted it more than anyone else. You know, I mean, he's a great athlete, but what Chris Benoit has, I mean, very few people in wrestling have. You know, I mean, it was just a natural love for wrestling and a desire. You know, I'm glad he's making a lot of money now, but, you know, Chris went all those places and did all those styles, and I don't think it was ever about the money for him. I think it was always about being a great wrestler. And Chris is a perfectionist as a wrestler, very different from a lot of guys. I mean, a lot of wrestlers, you know, they think that you know, their matches are great. You know, Chris will have a great match, you know, and think that it should be better. Eddie Guerrero is also like that. You know, they're, you know, I think that's why they became two of the best, was because of their standards were higher than everyone else as far as like what they set for themselves, as far as in the ring.
A lot of people can guess now and say, if he'd done that, it wouldn't have happened. If he did that, or it could have all been avoided, or if... But it happened, and it's hard to turn the clock back and say that it didn't happen. Nobody knows quite for sure how, what actually caused the accident, but... Vincent didn't ask him to do anything that he wouldn't have asked anybody else to do. I know Owen and Vince got along pretty well, and Owen was well treated, that they loved him, and he did a good job for them.
Well, the oldest child of the Hart family was Smith, who was born in New York City. Smith had a brief stint as a wrestler in the 70s. Was the first one to actually break into the wrestling business. Was considered a good, solid performer. Had his hand in promoting in Antigua and various shows in Alberta. Also did extensive training with the IWE wrestling office in Japan in 1974. Bruce was the second oldest. He was born in Great Falls, Montana. Was a great all-around athlete, loved sports all throughout his life. Had his wrestling debut in the early 70s. His career was cut short with a really bad collarbone injury, which sidelined him for almost a year. When he came back, he had tremendous success in the mid-heavyweight division, which Bruce helped found with a lot of other stars like the Dynamite Kid. Bruce continued to have success wrestling, but eventually became the booker for the Stampede promotion and had a pretty successful run during the 80s and in the 90s when Stampede Wrestling came back. Certainly one of the most well-known wrestlers in the family for his matches and being the booker of the promotion. Keith was the third oldest. He was also born in Great Falls, Montana. Another great all-around athlete. Also wrestled amateur extensively for the University of Saskatoon. Was considered maybe the toughest all-around wrestler as far as submission wrestling, and certainly anyone who could handle himself in the ring against any difficult types. But he debuted shortly after Smith and Bruce in the mid-70s while he was still attending university, and was respected as a good all-around worker. Worked a lot in tag teams and in the mid-heavyweight division, and formed a successful tag team with Brett. They held the tag team title, I think, on at least three occasions in the late 70s and early 80s. And Keith became a firefighter in the early 80s and limited his wrestling, but continued to wrestle and be involved with training right up until the early 90s. Wayne was the fourth oldest. He was born in Calgary. Was never really involved as a wrestler. He had a few matches, but for the most part was one of the best referees. And behind the scenes, he set up rings. Was a driver. He helped get the wrestlers to all the shows, even during the most difficult weathers, during the worst winter driving. You can imagine Wayne was the safest man behind the wheels. Very, very respected, very serious, conscientious approach with wrestling, and sometimes was overlooked for all he contributed to making the shows a big success. Dean was the fifth oldest. Dean was considered one of the most tenacious and fearless of all the hearts. Enjoyed the scrappier side of wrestling. He'd wrestled amateur and played a number of sports. Never really got involved in professional wrestling as a performer, but was a capable referee and also a ring hand, and he'd tried his hand at promoting in Hawaii and Samoa. Was certainly well known by the hearts as someone who stood up for the family and the name, and wouldn't back down against any odds, no matter who it was or what their size was. And for his size, Dean was probably the toughest all-around son of all the Harts. The sixth child and the first daughter, born to Stu and Helen Hart, was Elizabeth, or Ellie. She was blessed with many of my parents' best qualities. Stu's resourcefulness in building and fixing things, and my mom's intellect and wit. Ellie was a tremendous craftsperson. She could sew and design things, very artistic. She was great with sculpturing and made some of the most beautiful dolls and wrestling action figures that many wrestlers came to love. She certainly had her feminine side, but she ended up marrying Jim the Anvil Neidhart, who had been wrestling for her father, and their marriage still exists today. They've been married over 30 years, which is tremendous considering all the ups and downs that wrestlers go through. And Ellie has also raised three beautiful daughters, and her second oldest daughter, Natalie, is now one of the top divas in the WWE. And Ellie set some great examples for her younger sisters to follow. The second daughter born into the Hart family was Georgia. She also had many strengths of her parents. She was a tremendous cook and chef and was responsible for many of the wonderful meals that wrestlers had at the house. My dad enjoyed having many wrestlers and celebrities over for some of our famous Sunday dinners following wrestling shows, and Georgia was always a big part of that, and was really a source of bringing the family together for those special Christmas and Thanksgiving occasions. Married BJ Annis, who had a brief stint as a professional wrestler, and their son Ted has become one of the best known new generation performers, doing very well with the AAA promotion today in Mexico. But Georgia has been one of the real keys in keeping the family together, and certainly has had her own shares of difficulties and challenges, but been a tremendous mother and sister to everyone in the family. Brett was the next one born. The sixth son, blessed with a lot of athletic abilities, also very artistic, as many people saw in some of his books that he released. Brett grew up following wrestling a lot like his older brothers and enjoyed it very much, was a great amateur wrestler, had won the provincial championships on a couple of occasions after a successful high school wrestling career. Brett was a natural when he first started in the late 70s. He'd been trained a lot by Mr. Hedo and Mr. Sakurada, and had learned a lot of submission style wrestling from his father Stu, but Brett became one of the elite stars for Stampede Wrestling, famous for his matches with Dynamite Kid, Archie the Stomper, Goldie, Bad News Allen, and had a tremendous career after he had left Stampede, went to the WWF in the mid-80s, and his career skyrocketed with the Hart Foundation, in which he tagged with his brother-in-law, Jim Neidhart, and they had great matches with the British Bulldogs, and held so many titles there, the World Heavyweight title, the Intercontinental title, the Tag Team title, and eventually went on to enjoy success with the WCW before his career was tragically cut short by a concussion. still keeps very active with wrestling. Considered one of the most respected technicians in the game, and still very much loved and admired by so many people in the industry. Allison was the third daughter born into the family. Very quiet, reserved. Allison had some excellent bookkeeping and office skills. I think she really learned a lot from my mom growing up in the house, because my mom had to keep track of all the financial reports and income tax reports for the family. And Allison just learned a lot of those clerical skills from my mom, and went on to become a successful librarian, and did marry a professional wrestler, Ben Basarab, and raised two wonderful daughters. Allison continues to work as a librarian today, and has become the real historian for the family, collecting a lot of the family and wrestling archives, and restoring a lot of those original documents to their original form. Ross was the seventh son. Also had a real love and passion for the wrestling industry. Corresponded with a number of reporters and writers from other territories, and had a real pulse on who the bigger stars were in the American and European and Asian markets. Got involved with the production of the Stampede Wrestling TV show, was the executive producer of the weekly show that went all across Canada, and involved really behind the scenes more than anything with the TV production and booking the live shows in Calgary and out of town. The 11th child and the last of Stu and Helen's daughter was the lovely Diana, a gorgeous blonde who attracted many males who were always a little fearful of Diana's burly father, Stu, who kept an eye on his youngest daughter. But Diana played more of a background role in the family with her sisters. She stayed behind the scenes, but she was very artistic, had beautiful writing and drawing skills. Her status changed when she married an Englishman, Davy Boy Smith, who had been making a name for himself on her father's promotion in the early 80s, and they had a great relationship, raising two kids, and her son Harry now is one of the WWE stars and making a name for himself. And the last of the family, Owen, the 12th child and the 8th of the sons. Owen was a tremendous athlete. Being the youngest of all the children, he learned quickly to establish an identity of his own. Loved wrestling, loved many sports. Grew up following a lot of his older brothers who had become successful stars in their own right. But Owen, it seemed destined to wrestle because he just had so much athletic talent. He made a name for himself as an amateur wrestler competing for the University of Calgary, and when an injury sidelined his older brother, he stepped in and debuted in the mid-80s and never really looked back. Owen was always considered perhaps the most talented of all his brothers, excelling in the acrobatic and technical wrestling, and just a very steady performer. Had a wonderful career in Stampede, and wrestled throughout Germany and England and Japan and Mexico. He loved traveling. Eventually did follow his brother Brett's footsteps and had two successful runs in the WWF. Tragically, the second one, which led to his death in 1999, and always remembered as a tremendous athlete and competitor, but also a wonderful husband to his wife Martha and their two children. a lot of the training for wrestling is credited to the basement, which later became known as the dungeon, and that's where Stu enjoyed usually weekly sessions on Sundays, which was about the only day he had off from running a 6 or 7 day promotion, and his sort of escape from the family and all the phones ringing and activities going on in the house. But Stu would enjoy working out with wrestlers usually on Sundays and occasional evenings during the week, and this is where he practiced his craft with the submission style wrestling. And Stu did this with George Gordienko and Luther Lindsay. He helped teach them the real art of submission wrestling, and they became real powerhouses in wrestling themselves. But for Stu, it was his way of really teaching wrestlers how to respect the industry and really how to use submission wrestling as a form of defense against any would-be critics or anybody who used other martial arts, be it boxing or karate, and really wanted to test a wrestler, or just any fans that might jump a wrestler or want to take a wrestler on for size. But Stu was responsible for breaking in a lot of some of the better known wrestlers in the 50s and 60s, including Gordienko and Luther Lindsay, Archie the Stomper Goldie, superstar Billy Graham, so many others. But he also began teaching this with his sons. Once his oldest sons became more interested in wrestling and started filling out in their teen years, Stu would teach them submission holds and a lot of techniques. And really, Stu had no interest in his sons breaking into professional wrestling, but he encouraged all of us to pursue amateur wrestling as well as other sports. And as it turned out, a lot of us ended up going into professional wrestling as well. It just seemed a natural transition with the shows that we're running every week, and Smith and Bruce were largely the first ones that broke into wrestling, but they were taught basically some basic moves by Stu. But because of Stu's full-time commitment to promoting and looking after the household and still raising a family of 12 kids, his exposure really was limited to amateur wrestling and just basically covering the fundamentals of wrestling, you know, how to lock up, ways to properly fall, and countering some moves, you know, headlocks, arm locks. But his oldest sons, Smith, Bruce, and Keith, had a number of workouts, and then a lot of us, the younger brothers, would be fascinated and watch Stu working out, toying with guys, but he was always very instructional in what he was doing. He, you know, there was always a real system in how to trap guys in these holds and how to defend yourselves, how to escape or counter any moves. But it certainly was the foundation for a number of the stars who made it in Stampede Wrestling, and the training that went on for decades after. Bruce watched with interest a lot of my dad's teachings, and in the mid-80s, when Stampede Wrestling was making quite a comeback, started his own training camp, called it the Hart Brothers Camp, and joined forces with my brother Keith, and had a real hands-on school. They hired Mr. Hedo as an assistant instructor, and Hedo had been a very respected teacher. He had helped break in Brett many years ago, and Brian Pillman had come on as sort of the fitness instructor after his football career had been cut short with the Calgary Stampeders. So it was a very well-rounded team approach with the Hart Brothers Camp, Bruce and Keith teaching most of the basics, how to fall, how to go into the ropes, how to climb the ropes, how to execute all of the basic moves, and then Brian Pillman was in charge of a lot of the conditioning and fitness drills for the wrestlers, and Mr. Hito teaching more of the technical skills, as he had been a successful teacher with so many other younger wrestlers. And the Hart Brothers camp certainly propelled the name value of wrestlers from the dungeon. You know, there's still an emphasis on the submission wrestling that Stu had taught for so many years, but now it was a more well-rounded approach to really covering all the basics of wrestling, you know, the mat wrestling, and then looking at each individual wrestler and their strengths and talents, and how to develop their character and their persona and their interview skills. And Bruce and Keith ran this successful camp and attracted many stars from all over the world, and among the most prominent ones who did train there were Chris Benoit and Pillman and Owen, who did a lot of his training there, and Keichi Yamada, who later became famous as Jushin Liger, and Gary Albright, and many others, you know, who got their initial training in the dungeon. Bruce and Keith kind of went their own ways and continued running their own camps. Bruce continued running his camp throughout the 80s and 90s, and went on to continue training many of the younger generation stars in 2000, including his nephews Harry and Ted, and T.J. Wilson, Natalie Neidhart, many of them who owed a lot of their training to Bruce. And Keith had set up his own camp, also using the name the Hart Brothers Camp, and was responsible for the development of stars like Lance Storm and Chris Jericho. So both Bruce and Keith were very well regarded as teachers and mentors and role models to a number of stars in the 80s, 90s, and in the new millennium.